And I had no part of preaching 50 years old. I did not wake myself up.
All right.
I did not place myself in my mother's womb. I did not care for myself. I did not feed myself. But for 18,250 days, sunrise opening up. Your eyes closed like the beauty of the sunrise coming down. So everything in between there is beauty personified. So my children, Jasmine, Jordan, where you at? Where's she at?
Am I your wife?
Oh, she better be here. Where's my other one? Okay, Zion Kira, to the mom who has allowed us to take them in as our own. My church family, blessings. Love to you, and thank you for your patience with me. I had this shirt on today, and when I put it on this morning, I'm a record right now. It does say Browns, Cleveland Browns. I had the shirt on this morning and my wife, and I sat there and I ironed it and I laid it out so I could put it on. And my wife looked at me like, "You wearing that to church?" And I was like, "Yeah." And she just left it at that. I said, "Oh Lord, I don't know what's gonna happen now." But here's the thing. It does say Cleveland Browns, and all of you know we are from Cleveland. And I am a huge homer for Cleveland teams. I don't care how good, how bad, how ugly, I'm a homer for Cleveland teams. Now, I'm not about to give you this whole thing, but just bear with me here. And I wore this shirt to school, and I wore some of my other Cleveland paraphernalia to school. And all of a sudden, I don't bother nobody, Pastor. Don't bother a soul. I walk in there, and people just start ridiculing me, and it's like, "You are wearing that? You must be from Cleveland. I wouldn't be caught dead in that." And they just started ridiculing me about every last shirt that I wore and said, "Man, like when the playoffs are going on, oh, how do you feel LeBron's not there?" And just hit me at the core of things, you know? And one kid was talking to me and he's talking about the idea, "Oh, Mr. Harold, Cleveland's not in it this year. Cleveland's not in it this year. And I'm going from Milwaukee. I'm going up from Milwaukee." I said, "Where are you born?" And he's like, "I was born here in Virginia." "Okay. Hey, oh, Giannis, start talking about the Giannis, whatever the guy's name is, his old long name. But the basketball player that's from the superstar, I guess, basketball player for the Milwaukee Bucks." So I asked the kid, "Where's Milwaukee at?" "Shit." Couldn't answer that. "Okay, so name me everybody else that's on the Milwaukee team. Just give me the starting five." "Actually, don't even give me five, just give me two more players. Give me one more player that's on the team besides Giannis." Couldn't do it. So now you are basically saying that you are bandwagoning your team. That's, you don't know anything about them, but now you are 100% behind them, right? I'm not letting it go yet. Because there's a reason behind your madness. I'm just getting it out. But here's the thing. But it happens in so many things that they are actually just bandwagoning. And so when I actually was sitting with my brother right there, we were sitting down breaking down the word, I actually started coming to this word that he actually used. It was actually a multitude. Bandwagoning? A multitude. And I started sitting down just studying the idea of the multitude, because I've seen that over and over in Scripture, but I really started to sit back and just think about it and study what are the dynamics of a multitude. And sometimes you will see a phrase in the Bible as a crowd, but what are the dynamics there? If it's continuously seen a multitude here, a multitude here, a multitude here, then there's got to be something behind this multitude. So I started just to study a little bit that more, and Lord, what is it that is about this multitude? What are the characteristics of this multitude? And is it characteristics of the multitude that we should have? What can we learn from it? Are the characteristics that we should not have? I said, okay. Start breaking it down. Now, this may be a little unorthodox because, man, I was all over as far as scriptures are concerned. So just listen to me now. There are going to be some scriptures that we get in the second half to kind of hone it in some, because we're going to compare the difference between and define what a multitude is and then what a Christian disciple looks like. And so the scriptures, a lot of what you're going to see that may flash up there are primarily related to a Christian disciple. And notice I did choose my words correctly. I said a Christian disciple. Yes, sir. So now we start off. If you want to follow along with me, you can go to John chapter 6. Because a lot of the characteristics of a multitude, you can find right there. And we're not going to read all of it. I'm just going to jump through some of the things so you can pull out some of the major characteristics of it. First thing is the idea that when I sat there and looked at this, the title of it was Jesus' Bandwagon. Don't get on board. Jesus' Bandwagon. Don't get on board. So when we start there and look at it, we're going to look at the characteristics, first of all, of a multitude or a crowd. So first of all, a multitude is, it's attracted to what's popular. It's attracted to what's popular. So now let's go to John chapter 6, verse number 2 and 3. And it says, "A great multitude followed him," him meaning Jesus, "because they saw his miracles, which he did, on them that were diseased." Mm-hmm. other words, let's start breaking it down. So we see that the multitude, first of all, let's get the idea of this large crowd of followers. It is a multitude. They have all come, and the first characteristic, and they come because it's what's popular. They have heard of the miracles they've done. They've heard of great signs he's done, and they want to witness it for themselves. But they also may come because they want to experience the miracle themselves, because they have been sick with palsy. They may have a leprosy, but they may want to experience something or have an encounter with the one that is so popular. But do they know it? Yes, what are some of the things when the idea when Jesus performed miracles, he was performing miracles, we can say that he performed miracles first to glorify God. Second, he performed miracles to truly help others. And the third reason he performed miracles was to prove that who he was, who he said he was, and that is
Son of God.
Son of God. So the people would come to him for that, but it's, and I started to look at it like, man, are our intentions the same way as their intentions were? Meaning that our intentions kind of misguided in certain aspects, because he can heal them, and he gave demonstration that he can heal them physically, but that wasn't his purpose. The ultimate purpose was that he wanted to make them whole. So now we look at it, our intentions can get misguided in that we come to Jesus to heal our circumstances. But ultimately, Jesus wants to make us whole. He wants to restore us in right relationship with him through faith in Jesus Christ. And I understand that we come and we have so many things that ache us, so many things that ail us, but ultimately, we need to be made whole, healed from the inside out. Second thing is they were attracted to selfish ambition. Let's go down to 24, John 6, 24 through 26. It says, when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. They went after him strong. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, teacher, truly not understanding who they had in front of him, teacher, when camest thou hither? When'd you get here? Jesus answered them and said, truly, truly, or verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles. Now this comes right after he had just fed the 5,000 the day before. You saw me, you had just saw me because of the miracles, but because ye did eat loaves and were filled. In other words, y'all didn't come to me to truly accept me as Savior. You didn't see me for who I truly was. You came because you're hungry again. And you may not even be hungry now, but you already planned for your meals for the rest of the week. You're not coming after me for the right reasons. Multitude wanted more than just bread. They also wanted to another display of a miracle king to lead them against the Roman oppressors. To not only fill me physically, but now actually, because we are being oppressed by the Roman Empire, we want you to politically restore us back, or restore us into a sovereign, mighty nation.
Yes, sir.
For the wrong reason. Our own selfish ambition. I found this, and it was by a man named McLaren. He said, they were quite unaffected by the wisdom of his words and the beauty of his deeds, but a miracle that found food precisely met their wants. And so there was an excited but impure enthusiasm, which was very unwelcome to Jesus. We see applications of modern-day multitudes. Multitudes of meaning modern-day people often come to see what they can get, but not what they can give.
Yes, sir.
Love to hear the sermon or the read or hear the powerful prayers, and they're very quick to serve, but not have a true heart of service, and want to be served, but not have a heart of service towards the other brothers and sisters. In other words, it's self-centeredness. Lack of sincerity, This is my ministry, and some of the things you give example of it. This is my ministry. I started this ministry. I'm in charge of this ministry. It is what I say. Go. Unless you consult with Jesus Christ every single day and guide us in that ministry, it was never yours to begin with.
Amen.
And just as quickly as you are put there, you can be taken away. Everything we do should be in the name of Jesus Christ as our Savior. Everything we do should be for His glory.
Yes, sir.
It could mean the work that I do in school, every test I make for the kids should be done to His glory.
Yes, sir.
Everything, everything, every conversation should be done to His glory.
Yes, sir.
Everything. Every job I do should be done to His glory. There was a sign that says free money and free food. You'd probably get a bigger crowd of people coming for that.
You said that.
And if it says spiritual fulfillment and eternal life, and that's in the church. The application, people look for personal clout because they continuously jump ship and go with the winning sports team, won't support losing team. In other words, just like one day you're for this team because they're riding away. The next day I jump ship, I go to this team because they're riding away to victory. The next team I jump. Okay, so what does that look like spiritually? I jump from this church and I ride that way. I jump to this church because I ride that way. I jump to that church because I ride that way, but I don't make my roots anywhere.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Wow.
Yes, sir.
Third, attracted to teaching. And when the multitude heard this, they were astonished at His doctrine. Go to Matthew 22:33. You can also cross-reference Matthew 7:28, Mark 12:17. You can even go to when Jesus was actually a young boy, and He actually was sitting among the other scholars, and He began to teach them, and they were like, what kind of man is, young man is this? Okay. He can reason the Word of God and teach it so deeply. In other words, they were astonished with amazement. Jesus taught the multitudes with parables, and then He expounded deeper truths in private to His disciples because He understood that the multitude was not ready.
Yes, sir.
They could not understand the deeper meanings of the Word of God. They're still babies. They're still on the milk. They're not ready for the deeper substance, but yet they can still get strong from the milk. In other words, God will meet you right where you are. And He will carry you through your faithfulness, through your obedience. So what may not be clear one day, as you continually stay with Him and take His wise counsel, and you continually lift yourself up in humility to Him, He will counsel you, He will educate you through the power of His Holy Spirit. So once what may seem hard becomes a whole lot easier through faith.
Yes, sir. Preacher.
Continuously setting yourself apart for God's good work.
Yes, sir.
Jesus taught the multitudes, and they were astonished by His teaching. They didn't want to live it. They came to a certain point, and then when the rubber hit the road, when it became a little bit too hard, or started to prod a little bit too much, then all of a sudden, whoa. Can I just stay back here? I'm comfortable back here. This feels good right here. I don't want to give this up yet. Can I have both the best worlds? What does it look like? Hear a message, Pastor. That was a good message. And you come up here and you talk to Pastor, you meet him in the back. Oh, Pastor preached today. Hallelujah. He preached today. That was a good message, Pastor. That was a good message. And everything you know, and then you don't reflect upon it in your time for the rest of the week. By Wednesday, you forgot what he said. By Tuesday, you probably forgot what he said. But you just said it was a great message. You were touched by it. It touched your spirit. It moved your soul. But what happened next. Next one, you're unattracted to commitment. Let's go down to verse number 60. Many therefore of his disciples, when they had heard this, they said, "This is a hard saying. Who can hear it? This is too hard for me." Then 66 says, "From at that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him." His disciples. Now you got to listen, because all before this he was saying multitude, multitude, and all of a sudden John now switched it, and now he's talking disciples. In other words, a disciple is a learner or a follower. So first he was talking about the whole multitude, now it's becoming more intimate, and now he's talking about his disciples. And he says, and the multitude, they rejected it, and his disciples, some of the ones that had been walking with him, that said, "Oh, great, under his teaching," when he got to this point, too hard, it's too hard. They started to reject it to the point where some turned and walked completely away. The Word of God says that I shouldn't gossip. I should not say it. I really shouldn't even listen to it. It becomes too hard, so I do it anyway. God tells me I should not essentially consume alcoholic drinks as a beverage for intoxication. It comes too hard. I'll just do this part of it. What God tells me, I should not fire up. Come on. Too hard. I'm still going to do some of it. God tells me that I should love my brothers and my sisters, love everyone, even when they hurt me. Shouldn't flare up in anger. It's too hard. I just need to cuss every once in a while. Help me feel good. So when we do these sins, willfully sin, we're no better than his disciples, his learners, his followers, because we at that point have now turned away from what we've been taught. We have turned our back on the Word of God. We have turned our back, in essence, on God. Acts chapter 2, verse 21 through 26. This is a crazy thing. If you go back and read that, this was at the point where Judas had passed away, committed suicide. And now they're at the point of trying to find a new apostle to bring on. And there is essentially 120 that they have to choose from. And at the end of the 120 that they had to choose from, there were only two that they could make a decision on. And one was chosen. And these are the ones, these were people who had walked with Jesus through his earthly ministry. I've been saved 15 years. I've been saved 20 years. I've been saved 30 years. I've been saved 40. I've been saved 5, 2, 1. You get the number. God had to choose. The apostles had to choose. One of us. Would we be chosen? Because they were led by the Holy Spirit to be chosen. Would I be chosen? At some point, we will all have to give an account of our lives. And we will not have to give an account of our lives to man. We will have to give an account of our lives to the one who created man. Who knows all? Who sees all?
can make up something new. I can make up something my wife can get away with it. The crazy thing is that it was applied to the followers of Christ because they were taught by him. What this means, this idea of a disciple, is it does not mean, it does not imply that those to whom it was given were real Christians. You're probably getting that now. Simply that they were under his teaching and they were so-called learners in his school. They were so-called learners in his school. But when the rubber hit the road, they turned their back. The beauty about this is that when you are in a relationship with Christ, he is faithful and just to forgive us of all sins and unrighteousness. So even in our disobedience, even if it is a willful disobedience, he is faithful and just to forgive us of all sins and unrighteousness. And that means I get another chance. I get another opportunity. But the cool thing is that he doesn't leave me alone. Through the Holy Spirit, he will walk with me and counsel me and bring back to remembrance everything that I've learned of him. He will counsel me. He will rebuke me. He will correct me. But it will all be out of love. Why? Because he loves me. Because he loves us. So then we looked at the multitude. Now let's look at what a Christian disciple or a true fan looks like. First of all, they are a worshiper of Jesus. Let's go to John chapter 4, verse 24. It says, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Since God is a spirit, we must receive spiritual worship because he's present everywhere. To worship in spirit means that you are concerned with the spiritual truths of his word. Not so much with the places, not so much with buildings, not so much with our sacrifices. You are concerned about your spirit and spiritually entering into worship with him. Laying aside everything and everyone. Worship in truth means that it's sincere. It means that you worship according to the whole teaching, the whole counsel of the Word of God. I don't leave certain parts out that I don't like. I don't leave parts out that are uncomfortable. I worship him, and all of it is true. I accept all of it is true, and I follow all of it sincerely. Also means that you come to God in truth, not in any make-believe, shape, form, or fashion. You cannot finesse God. Jesus puts. Dale knows that I'm a huge soccer fan too, and he knows if he starts talking about soccer, he brings it up. He's gonna have to put me on the clock because that's what I'm gonna stop talking about. But he knows that's where I am. So, and I light up because when I talk about it, I truly enjoy it. Well, here's the same thing. If Cardell knows that I'm a great soccer fan, I have failed him if he doesn't know I am even a greater lover of Jesus Christ. With the same excitement and even greater excitement that I light up about talking about soccer or anything else I love, my family and all that, there should be a greater excitement and a greater smile and a greater joy when I talk about the Word of God. And even if I'm not talking about the Word of God, when I'm just sitting there and I hear the Word of God being preached, when I hear the Word of God being sung, when I hear the prayers of God, when I turn around and look and I see other people in pure worship, that excites me. Trying to tell us that we need to put Jesus first in all things. All means all. Every last thing. That's a little word. All is a little word, but it's a huge that encompasses all. The disciple of Christ needs to be set apart from the world. In other words, I can't be in the world and in Jesus Christ. It don't work that way. That means the relationships I have should be ones that are rooted with others that are in the Word of God. Why? So they can build me up, I can build them up, we can build each other up. If I surround myself with people that are not in the Word of God, if I surround myself with people who are still in the world, I have the opportunity to fall back in because they're going to draw me back in. They're going to put me in uncompromising positions. Not so much they will. I will put myself in them because I will follow along with them. Talked about the idea of boundaries. I don't care about football, basketball, baseball teams, any other team. I will watch sports, but I do not have an affinity for any other team unless there's Ohio in front of it. That's just what it is. So, spiritually, my affinity should be for Jesus Christ, period. I do not have an affinity with the things of this world or a love for the things of this world. Follow his teachings. Obedience is the supreme test of our faith. If you want to read further about what does true obedience look like, Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. Who being in the form of God, in Jesus, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in the fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient even until death on the cross. So when I come to truly worship God through it's not just words, it is my whole lifestyle. It's a lifestyle of worship. And as I worship him, I am connected to the vine. You go to John chapter 15, verses 5 through 8. And as a result of that, I become more obedient to the Lord, and I will walk with him. I will walk with the Spirit through the guidance of the Spirit, and I will display the fruit of the Spirit. I will display the fruit of the Spirit. I cannot produce it myself. I cannot produce righteousness in myself. Through my faith in Jesus Christ, I am in right standing with God, but I cannot produce and make myself righteous. But when I submit myself to his holy will, I can produce the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Change we seek is done from the inside out. I heard this once before, that if I have dirty pipes, and I pump clean water through some dirty, moldy pipes, what's going to come out on the other end is now dirty water. So therefore, I need to replace those pipes. So now when that water pumps through, it pumps through clean pipes, and what comes out on the other side is still clean water. A lot of y'all, into Brita, right? The Brita filters? Okay. So, just think of your life outside of Christ. Is that water? Word of God is that filter. Pour myself a lot out. What comes out of it is purified through my faith in Christ. Servant. Second one is a servant of Jesus. A Christian disciple is a servant of Jesus. Verse Mark 10:45 tells us, for even the Son of Man came not to be ministered, meaning to serve, to be served, but unto, he came to be, he did not come. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered or served unto, but to minister, meaning to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Ransom for many means that, essentially means that he died so that we'll be free from the power of sin and death.
Amen.
Eternal separation from God. Now, that don't move y'all. I may not be sitting and hooping and hollering, but at the end of the day, dude, that is huge.
All right, now.
That is huge. But again, there's a new command that I give unto you, that ye shall love one another as I have loved you, and that ye also love one another. By this it shall know that ye are my disciples, if you have love one for another. Serve, Christian disciple means to be a servant. Last, you have to be a witness for Jesus. You have to be a witness for Jesus. We are called to be a witness for Jesus. Matthew 28:18-20 tells us, all power is given unto me. And Jesus said and spake unto them, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whosoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. The end of the world. To be a disciple of Jesus means to point people to him. That's it. To be a Christian disciple means to be a witness for Jesus. It means to be a servant of Jesus. It means to worship Jesus. My kids, when they were 2 years old, they were young, about what, four when they first came? About five or six, they came home and said that they wanted to play soccer. When we were back in Cleveland, they were like in second grade, so a little bit older. About the second grade, and they came home to my wife and I and said, hey, mommy and daddy, we want to play soccer. I looked at her, she looked at me, and we were like, black people play soccer. They know nothing about soccer. I was ready to go get basketball. At some point, I'm like, well, where'd y'all get that from? But they came with an excitement about it. And because they had an excitement about it, okay, then I'm going to support their excitement. That's just what you do as a parent. So we supported their excitement, and as we supported their excitement, we started to look at the game, and Ms. Celeste even was a coach for them for a little while, believe it or not. But we started to support their excitement, and all of a sudden, we started to get excitement, and I started to get excitement. I started to actually feel the same passion and enjoyment that they felt for the game. I started to feel it for myself. And then it just kept growing and growing to the point where it was no longer just an emotional attachment to it. It became, well, now, dude, I want to actually learn this game, and I want to actually sit down and study it. So I should spend time, even when I wasn't a coach, I would just spend time learning the game because there was an excitement I had for it. So now when I have a conversation with them, I can begin to teach them, but at the same point, I was thoroughly enjoying this game. And it just kept growing and growing and growing. So then all of a sudden, as I got the excitement, okay, now it's got to the point where, dude, I am all in on this. You come to my house at 9 o'clock in the morning. You come to my house at 12 o'clock at night. You come to my house at 1 a.m. in the morning. And if there's a soccer game on, guess who's watching it? And I may have one recorded. Because I just enjoy it that much, and the beauty of it all, that I have a passion and a love for it. And I have a desire to learn more and more about it. Just like my Christ. It's just like my salvation. They were witnesses to me. My kids, they were a witness to me about soccer. And as a result of them being a witness for me, I bought into it because of their excitement. I didn't understand their excitement. I didn't understand the game, but I bought into their excitement. And as a result of buying into their excitement, I took it upon myself and said, okay, I do. I'm going to learn more about this, not for them, but for me now. It started to switch. So then I took it on. I believed it. I accepted it. I started to enjoy it. I started to live it out. And now, as a result of that, you talk to me about it, I will compare it to any other sport, and I will tell you how great this game is. Some point, somebody came to you and told you about the Word of God, and you didn't understand everything they were saying to you about it. But they said they met you at a moment of need, and they met you at a point that you were willing to take a step and say, I'll find out more about it. Now, for some, it may have taken longer than others, but you were still willing to do it. And as a result of doing it, you then took it upon yourself when you said, yes, I do believe. And as a result of you then believing, you now are a servant for God. You are now part of his family, and you are now witnesses. We are all witnesses for our Savior. Romans 10:9-13. We've talked about what the multitude is, or a bandwagon thing is. We've talked about what a Christian disciple is, and that is a true fan, we'll say. And then we're going to talk about those who are just not fans whatsoever. You can still become a fan. How do I know that? Because if you acknowledge and profess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, recognizing his power and authority and majesty as God, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For the heart of a person, meaning believes in Christ as Savior, resulting in his justification, that is being made righteous, being freed of the guilt of sin, and made acceptable to God. And with the mouth, he acknowledges and confesses his faith openly, resulting in and confirming his salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him, whoever adheres to, trusts in, relies on him, will not be disappointed in the name of the Lord. And he is abounding in riches and blessing, and all who are called on him with faith, through faith and prayer. You can become part of the team. You can become a fan. You can become a Christian disciple. But it all starts with, I believe. I believe. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Tell the true fans, right? Because they follow the team no matter what. Amen. And then you can tell the ones who I call them fair weather. They're just a fan for the season because everything is working right for the team. You know, when you start talking about some of the best teams and the ones that won most of the Super Bowls, you know, back then, you know, quickly, it goes to the Pittsburgh Steelers, right? We all remember the terrible towels and the Mean Joe Green era, you know, and how many Pittsburgh fans. But if you are a true Pittsburgh Steelers fan, then you also remember when they couldn't buy a game. They couldn't win a game. I remember when they drafted Mean Joe Green, Terry Bradshaw. I thought they had lost their mind. I had never heard of North Texas State. Never heard of Louisiana Tech. What state is that in? That's where Terry Bradshaw came from. Mean Joe Green, North Texas State. But the true fans, they suffer quietly through the years of misery for the Pittsburgh Steelers. And then they started winning, and the multitude grew. Amen. They jumped on the bandwagon. Everybody was a Steeler fan. Amen. But the disciples are the ones who endure unto the end. They are the learners and followers of Jesus Christ. And they are following him because he is the Son of God.
Amen.
Stand with me. As we ponder this morning, why are you in this? Are you part of the multitude? Because it's Sunday, and this is what the multitude does on Sunday. Is this what it's all about? Or are you here as a disciple of Jesus Christ? As a learner, a follower of Jesus. So today you're here. And you have an opportunity to make a decision for yourself. Continue as among the multitude. Or will you become a follower, a disciple, a learner of Jesus Christ? It's as simple as this. The Bible says you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believing that God has raised him from the dead. Thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So if you're here today, and God is speaking to your heart right now, that you will become a follower of Jesus. If you are here today, would make that decision for Jesus, and this is your opportunity to do that. Why don't you come and give your heart to God? Are you here today? Are you here today? Let God speak to you right now. and we bless God for your decision. But presently, you're not a part of a church family. God has placed it upon your spirit to join with this branch of Zion. We would love to have you as a part of the Mount Olive Church family. So if you're here today and you would make a decision for Mount Olive, then why don't you come? And we will number you among the faithful here at Mount Olive. Are you here today? And you would make that decision today? And of course, anytime the church comes together, it's an opportunity for praise. It's a time for me to talk with God about the things that concern me, the things that may even hinder my walk in Christ Jesus.